We really need a lot of prayers for the street ministry because the devil hates it. You know, he hates that. And he hates the zeal of the saints. Amen. He wants to destroy that. He doesn't like that. So we have to keep praying, keep living for God, keep holy, keep separated from sin. Don't let any sin in your life. Repent of it, confess it, get it right. Don't let anything come in because that's where the devil gets a foot in the door when we have something like that. Amen. So let's just keep it pure and holy. Amen. All right. I hope you believe that. I hope you understand that. No matter, we could do all the works we want to do, but if we don't live holy, it's nothing but dung. That's what it is. It won't go anywhere. It won't have any power. Amen. Remember that. Be holy, the Lord says. Remember that. All right. Okay. All right. Turn your Bibles to Matthew chapter 16, please. All right. Looking forward to this. And a little different of a message here for you tonight. Something the Lord laid on my heart a few weeks ago, actually, and he's been dealing with me with personally in my life. And I think that it'll be a blessing for you, and it'll help you personally in your life as well. And that the child of God needs this. Okay, this message is called Biblical Temperance or Self-Control, the Missing Link in American Christianity. And I believe this wholeheartedly. As you study and as you look and you look around at what's going on in our world today, in fundamental Christianity in America, that is, in this country, there's an absolute lack of temperance or self-control in many areas, okay? And we're going to talk about some of those. And this is one thing that the Lord's been dealing with me about for about, I don't know, about a month now, I've thought about some things, and the Lord's laid on my heart some things, and I had to get right with God about some things myself and kind of understand where I'm at with some things and how I need to grow as a Christian and remember some things and not forget some things along the way in this path, this war that we're in, amen, this Christian life. So Matthew chapter 16, verse number 21, I'll read this to you. From that time forth began Jesus to show unto his disciples how that he must go into Jerusalem and suffer many things of the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed and be raised again the third day. Then Peter took him and began to rebuke him, saying, Be it far from thee, Lord, this shall not be unto thee. But he turned and said unto Peter, Get thee behind me, Satan. Thou art an offense unto me, for thou savorest not the things that be of God, but those that be of men. Then said Jesus unto his disciples, If any man will come after me. Now notice these next four words. Because they are the most difficult. They are easy words to say, but they are very hard words to live. Aren't they? Think about this. They're very hard words to live. Let him deny himself. Oh, man. I mean, not in America. We don't have to deny ourselves anything, right? We can have anything we want. We can do anything we want. We can reasonably, if something's not open in sin as a Christian, I mean, I can do whatever I want, really, if it's not a sin, right? No, that's wrong. Actually, it's wrong. Where do we get that from? We get it from ourselves. That's what. We get it from the flesh. But he says here, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it, and whosoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it. I want to read some more scripture to you here. Ezekiel chapter 16, verse number 49. You don't have to turn there because I'm going to go fast into another verse. But behold, this was the iniquity of thy sister Sodom, pride, fullness of bread. There's more, but I'm just going to read that part to you for the sake of this study here. And in 2 Peter chapter 1, the Bible says, add to your faith knowledge, and to knowledge temperance. Actually, add to your faith virtue, and to virtue knowledge, and to knowledge temperance, I believe. Let's turn there here. Make sure my notes are correct here. Because it is very possible they're not, so I want to make sure. No, you couldn't have a typo, could you? Yeah, I could, believe me. It's easy to do, right? All right. The Bible says in 2 Peter that we're to add to our faith, right? It says here, and besides this, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue. And to virtue, that's that moral purity. We talked about that on the radio show. That's that moral purity. Add to your faith virtue, and to virtue knowledge, and to knowledge temperance. See, temperance is also, we see it there. We also see another verse here. By the way, did you know that temperance is a fruit of the Spirit? Did you know that it's a part of that? Did you know that this temperance is a link in the chain of faith? That's why I called this message a temperance, a missing link. Because it's many times in American Christianity, it is one of the missing links that we don't exercise in our faith, that we don't add to our faith. Yes, it is a fruit of the Spirit. Temperance, Galatians chapter 5, temperance is a fruit of the Spirit. Amen. All right, so think about those things. Now, in Ezekiel chapter 16, verse number 49, I already read that. Proverbs chapter 25, verse number 28. He that hath no rule over his own spirit is like a city that is broken down and without walls. So the Bible is teaching us, God is teaching us here, that we have to have rule over our own spirit. So what is he saying? Self-control. But did you know that self-control is different for the Christian than it is for the lost person? It is different for the Christian than it is for the self-help gurus and everything else. Why is that? Because our self-control stems from us obeying the will of God. Because it is a fruit of the Spirit. It is a gift from God. Amen. So it begs the question, why don't we have it or why don't we practice it? We have it if we're saved. We've been given all things that pertain unto life and godliness. Amen? So we've been given it. Why aren't we adding it? Why aren't we practicing it? Let's pray. Father, Lord, we pray you'd bless us now. Help us with your holy word. Lord, help us understand these great truths. Oh, this biblical temperance, Lord, it's different for all men. All men struggle with different things, controlling the passions and desires of the flesh or of their life, Lord, and keeping everything under biblical submission. Help us now, Lord, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I don't pretend that these are very popular, talking about these things. They're really not. You know, it's more fun to rail on it's more fun for us to rail on the lost or rail on the wicked or to talk about the wicked. But you know what? We will never have the growth that we need in this life if we don't have biblical temperance. We will never be what God wants us to be if we don't have biblical temperance. What does that mean? That word means self-control. It's the virtue of one who masters his desires and passions, especially his sensual appetites. So it's taking control that stems from the Holy Ghost, not from our own selves, not from our own strength. But it's that spirit control. It's obeying the will of God and controlling the flesh and putting it in subjection to the Spirit. Amen. It's different for everybody, though. The struggle is different for everybody. That temperate means to be strong, robust, having power over, possessed of a thing, mastering, controlling, curbing, restraining. Amen? For some, it's constraining and controlling their emotions. So if something takes place, your whole world doesn't fall apart and you don't lose it and melt down to the ground like a 3-year-old or a 2-year-old. Right? What happens when you lose all control? That you are not being temperate in all things. When you lose control like that, you are not following, you are not walking in the Spirit, but you are given over to the flesh, and you and I are not temperate in all things. As we're commanded to be in the Scriptures, and I'll get to that. We're commanded to be temperate in all things. Man, that's a tall order, isn't it? Sure is. But we got a big Holy Ghost, don't we? Amen? It's controlling oneself, temperate, continent. It follows knowledge in that chain of faith. It follows it. Why? Suggesting that what is learned requires to be put into practice. That's what. Great, you learned all these facts and you know all these things about the Bible and you know all, and you can spit out all these, but let me ask you, do you put it to use? Because that's what temperance does. You can preach all day long. We can do everything all day long. We can teach all day long. We can do all of those things. But do we put it into practice? Excuse me. That is temperance. That is temperance, being able to put that into practice. Amen? listen, I knew I was preaching on fasting and said the Lord had me do that. But what kept sticking to me that God would not let go of was temperance. You need to preach on temperance first. Because without temperance, you won't fast or do anything like that. Without temperance. Nope. Of the scripture, self-control. Then is being in control of oneself in the context of the scriptures, the control of self, so as to be in harmony with the will of God. That's what it's about. It's not just whatever I wanted. No, it's God's word says this. This is the will of God. So now I need to be temperate and have control over myself, over my passions, my desires, my wants. Amen? I need to have control over my emotions. Now, it's like I said, everything's different. With ladies, many times it can be their emotions take control of them. When you, by the way, I know you're an emotional being, and I thank God he made you that way. I really do. I do, actually. I thank God for that. But I'll tell you what, when your emotions control you, you don't get to use that as an excuse that you're an emotional being. That's not an excuse. No, you're walking in the flesh. Just like if your husband gets angry or your husband does something, you are still walking in the flesh, allowing your emotions to control you. You are not being tempered by the Spirit of God. You are giving yourself over to your flesh. Amen. And that is sin. That is sin. Can't blame it on anything else but that. Amen. Another definition of this. Avoiding all excess, avoiding all excess in eating and drinking and all impure and unclean lusts. It talks about eating and drinking, you know, being able to control that. It's funny, about 4 weeks ago, man, I was sitting and I was praying, and I knew that God was dealing with me on something. And as you know before, some of you that were here before, you know that I lost a lot of weight. And I worked really hard. That Lee would know this, and some of the others would know this, that they were here at the time. I'd lost a lot of weight, worked really hard on it, ended up hurting my back, and I was lifting and working out, and all this, ended up hurting my back and wrenched myself up and, you know, kind of changed a lot of things and kind of messed me up a little bit, you know, got me messed up. And that's not an excuse. It's still my fault, amen, but it kind of got me messed up a little bit. So I gained weight. I wasn't as healthy as I should be. And about 4 weeks ago, the Lord worked on my heart about it. He had been working on my heart, and I was saying, you know what, I mean, pretty soon it's just going to snap at me, and I'm just going to be, like, done with it, and I'm going to do what I need to do to get back in shape and to do what I need to take care of myself. But I have to have this. I have to go to God with this, and I have to be like, that's it. I'm done. God, give me the grace to get through this, and I'm going to do it. I don't care what it is. I'm just going to do it. And that was about 4 weeks ago. And as of today, I've lost 24 pounds in 4 weeks. Yeah. And these guys can attest. They go out to eat. I don't eat the food. I don't eat the food. They say, do you miss it? Does it bother you? No. No, because I'm driven, and I'm going to do it. Why? Because I want to be a good example. That's why, number one. I want to honor the Lord with my life, number one. Number two, I want to be a good example to others that struggle with things. And I want to be temperate. Because I don't want to preach to druggies, to drug dealers, to wicked people, to people that are stuck in pornography, and me not have control or master my own body. And God has given me the gift to do it. He's given me temperance to do it. Amen. He's given us all things that pertain unto life and godliness. So for me, again, after 8 years ago, again, it came flushing through to my mind that the Lord was telling me that, you know what? This is not anything else but a spiritual conviction. And unless you see it as a spiritual conviction, you will never do anything about it. And it became a spiritual conviction again. And I said, I don't care what anybody else does. I don't care what they eat. I don't care what they do. I know what I have to do for my body. I don't care what anybody else's idea is. I'm doing what I know works and what I did before, and I'm gonna lean on the Lord, and I'm gonna do it. Amen. And I'll see it through by the grace of God. The point I'm making with this is to use myself as not to exalt myself, but to say this, that this is an example of biblical temperance. It's being able to look at something. And by the way, I'm not pointing a finger at anybody else here and saying this is what you need to do. I'm telling you what the Lord's doing at me, okay, with me. I'm not telling you. Some of you, it's not that. Some of you, it's a bad temper. You need to get a handle on your temper. Some of you, you don't have a tempered tongue, and you need to stick a stinking clip on it. Amen. Yeah, you need to bridle it. We're going to talk about that, Brother Paul. You need to bridle the tongue. Because you say some things that are destructive to people. You're destroying people with your tongue. Some of you, it is something else. I don't know what it is for everybody. It's not my job to know what it is. It's my job to preach this to you. And the Holy Ghost, believe me, He'll set down what needs to be. He'll bring it to your remembrance. Amen? All right, but anyway, so avoiding all excess in eating and drinking and all impure and unclean lusts, for it signifies nothing what a man knows or professes to know, if his life is a scene of intemperance and debauchery. Man, if you're nasty with everybody you know, it's wonderful you're Christian. You can read a bunch of verses to me and you can tell me a bunch about the Bible. But if you're mean and nasty with everybody you know, if you have a bad attitude with everybody you know, if you don't know how to conduct yourself, if you don't have temperance over your own, over yourself, well, great, that's wonderful. But I mean, who's going to believe that it matters if you're like that, if you have that? Nobody's going to believe that, right? Nobody's going to. Amen. This seems to be leveled, he says, against the followers of Simon Magus. I don't know. Magus, I got it. I got the thumbs up from Nate. All right. Who ascertained salvation to knowledge. Wait, you mean Simon? There was a guy that ascertained salvation to knowledge? Wouldn't that mean that he had a mental ascent? That's crazy. Can you believe that? Yeah, he did. He had a mental ascent. Though his life was ever so impure. We don't want that. We don't want people to say, hey, great, you had a mental ascent of salvation. That means you believed in... Listen, folks, you can believe in your head all you want to, but when it isn't a heart belief, your life don't change. You're the same person you always were. Amen. That's the problem with some. They've never been born again. Their life has never been changed. They've believed that, hey, they could tell you Jesus died, was buried, and rose again. They could tell you all those things. But nothing's changed in their life. He hasn't come inside of them and changed them and made them a new creature. All right. By the way, I happen to believe Simon was a sorcerer. He was a witch, by the way, a sorcerer, whatever you want to call him. It's witchcraft. By the way, do you know it's witchcraft to have a mental ascent and to lack the power thereof? Do you know that's nothing but witchcraft? That's all it is. Anyway, so you see, we have to have self-control, a mastering over the passions and desires of our flesh. We have to curb and restrain things in our lives. Why? Does everything have to be a sin for me not to do it? No. Did you know that? What is the difference there? Well, that's temperance. Amen? That's temperance. Do you know that? It doesn't have to be a sin for you not to do it. Maybe it's not temperance. Maybe I'm not able to beat my body in subjection like the Apostle Paul said, who's using his analogy. He didn't really beat his body. He's just saying that he put it in subjection. Amen? Doesn't have to be a sin for you to put it in subjection, does it? To restrain, to keep back something. Amen? All right. Everyone is different. Oh, by the way, let me just say something to you, because sometimes people don't realize this, and I want to help you out with something here. You can't look at one person or compare two people together. The Bible says comparing yourselves among yourselves is not wise. Okay? So for you and I to look at somebody, for you and I to look at one person, then look at the other person and say, well, this guy can eat like 3 cheeseburgers, he doesn't get fat. Right? And this guy, if he can eat half that sometimes, he can gain weight and he can be overweight. Now let me ask you a question. Which one, if those two scenarios are true, which one is the intemperate one? Both. Both can be. Do you see why? Because nobody needs 3 cheeseburgers, right? Nobody needs it to survive, right? Right? You don't need that, right? Come with me for a second. I'm trying to help you with something here. Nobody needs that, right? So then what happens? Well, let me ask you a question. Am I being good to my brother if I do that? Am I showing control or self-control? Possibly not. I can't answer that for you. You have to answer that. I'm just telling you that we can still put our body in subjection, even though we don't, even though it wouldn't be wrong for us to do that, maybe, or it doesn't affect us like it does somebody else. Wouldn't it be just as wrong if I did that? Am I being temperate in all things? Or do we go by an American standard as well? As long as you're not fat, you can do whatever you want. Do you see what, do you understand what I mean? Do you understand? That's the difference in temperance and just doing something right or wrong. That's the difference in it. Temperance means that I can do something, but I'm not going to because I'm going to restrain myself from doing it because I don't need to. Because it's not beating my body into subjection. Right? It's not putting my body into subjection, that is. It's not doing that. I'm not forcing my body to subject to the Spirit. You say, well, I don't have that problem. I know you've got other problems. You got a bad attitude and a temper a lot of times. Some of you run with your emotions more than you do common sense and more than you do the Bible. If something upsets you, you just fire off about it and you got to let everybody know about it. Amen. What? Why? Because you're not temperate. That's why. By the way, just because we want something doesn't mean that we need it or we should have it. Amen? See, this right here is real preaching. You know how I know it's real hard preaching? Because everybody's quiet. And I don't, that's good because you're thinking. And I want you to think. But that's what this is. This is challenging right here. Why? Because this is no longer talking about the sins of the world. This is the sins of the body. Amen? And I'm going to tell you something. You and I both need to hear things like this. Because this is what sharpens us and makes us powerful for the Lord. This is what makes us deny the flesh and take up our cross and follow Him. This is where judgment begins at the house of God. And we look inwardly. Why? So we can have the power of God. Amen. So we can have that. Why? Because we can lay down the flesh. We can just lay it down. We can crucify the flesh. And walk in the Spirit and have the power of God in our lives. You see, these things are uncomfortable. I know. Hey, I just told you I lost 24 pounds. That's uncomfortable. I didn't want to be 24 pounds more overweight than what I was. Okay? But the point is, it's true. That's real life right there. And you know what? There's about 1,000 to 2,000 pastors so far across the country or more that you could say that are completely intemperate with those things. Now, there's some other problems that they have. You can have physical problems and things like that. Just because somebody's overweight doesn't mean that they're intemperate all the time, okay? There's other things. There's physical things that are wrong with people. So stop looking at some stupid American chart and say, well, this is what you're supposed to look like. Yeah, who cares what you say? Am I following God? Am I being obedient? And do I have self-control? Amen? That's what matters. Not what some chart says, not what those models that are anorexic, all of them in Hollywood, those fake bodies that they make in a lab somewhere and just kind of put on everywhere, whatever. They put their nose on, they put their hair on, they put everything on. They're not real. If they get close to a fire, ooh, they're gone. And they're going to melt just like the Wicked Witch in the Wizard of Oz. All right? But that's, sorry, but that's, they're fake. That's right. They're fake women. They're not real. And that's gross. Anyway, all right. Sorry, it just is. Be real. Bunch of fakes. Amen. Bunch of nasty beanpole-looking weirdos. Anyway, all right. Galatians chapter 5, verse number 22. They got to be on dope and drugs and all kinds of things to look that scary. I mean, good night. All right, Galatians chapter 5, verse number 22. Remember this, though, before we read that verse. All things are lawful, but all things are not expedient. I could do a lot of things, but should I is the question. Paul said he had in his power to do a lot of things. He said, I could have a wife. I could do a lot of these things. I could forbear working. I could do a lot of these things, Paul said. But he didn't. Why? Because he said, all things are lawful, but all things are not expedient. Right. It's not the best for me to do those things. Amen? All right. Galatians chapter 5, verse number 22. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such as there is no law. Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these. Hey, how about this? Now these are like the exact opposite of what you should be doing. You just heard what the fruit of the Spirit is, right? Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these. Adultery, fornication. What is all this stuff? Uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variants, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like of the which I tell you before, as I have told, also told you in the times past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. What do we notice about this list? We don't want to be on it. That's what we notice, okay, first, right? Amen? Right? We notice I don't want to be on that list, all right? I don't want to be described as any of these things, all right? So guess what? We got to be careful that we're out there preaching whatever. Man, we're preaching against drunkenness. Amen. But we better be careful that we don't have revelings and we don't have immoderation in what we do and our eat and our drink and everything else. All right? We got to make sure that we're not full of idolatry. Maybe, you know what? There's a lot of people that, man, they have a different idol set up. They might preach against somebody's drunkenness or drug abuse, but they got an idol of their own set up. They're addicted to something, sports or whatever else. You know, they have an addiction to something like that that takes them and captivates them, and it takes their mind away from the Lord. Well, we're just as guilty then. Do you see how we've got to have biblical temperance to keep everything in the proper order that God wants it to be in? Amen. It says, I mean, envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings, wrath, strife, hatred. Man, how many people in Baptist churches today sit in pews or chairs like this every day and they have a heart full of hatred? But they'll see that druggie and they'll look at that druggie and they'll say, yeah, you wicked devil, you. Look at you doing all that wicked stuff. And they've got hate and bitterness and wrath in their heart. What's wrong with them? They're not temperate. They're not temperate in all things. They don't have self-control. They don't have control. They don't have control over themselves. Amen? Temperance is that fruit of the Spirit. By the way, it's a command. Like we said, it's a command to add to our faith. It's a command. It's a gift. But what is that saying then? Okay, how do I balance this? How do I understand this then? So temperance is a fruit of the Spirit, right? And it's a command to add. So how do I balance that out then? Don't I automatically just have it? Yes, you do. But what do you have to do? Exercise it. Everybody in this room has muscle. But unless they exercise it, they'll never know it's there. Right? Amen? That's the same thing with the fruit of the Spirit that you're being given. If you don't exercise it, if you don't put it into practice, if you don't put it into work, if you don't add that link into your chain of faith there that he's talking about here, then guess what? It won't manifest. It won't show. Amen? Some people think that they get saved and that everything's done for them. I mean, I don't have to do anything. See, I have the fruit of the Spirit. I have all this thing. Well, you know what? God leads you with that power when he gives you that fruit of the Spirit, when the Holy Ghost comes in. Guess what he leads you to do? Follow all of those attributes and gifts of the Holy Ghost. Do you know that there are some gifts that are fully transferable? Did you know there are some attributes of God that are fully transferable? You say, what do you mean by that? Well, you're not omnipotent, okay? You don't get that one, okay? You're not all-powerful. You're not all-knowing, okay? You're not omniscient. But what do you have? You have the goodness of God that he's placed inside of you. You have faith, the faith of Christ. You have other gifts that God, you have other gifts and fruit of the Spirit that God has given you. What are they? Why are they called fruit of the Spirit? Because they don't come from us. That's right, brother. They don't come from us. Where do they come from? God. An attribute of the Holy Ghost being inside of you. They are God's attributes given to you. It's for you to manifest and walk in the Spirit. That's what they're there for, and that's what they do. All right? Make sense? All right. Continence means this means self-government or moderation, principally with regard to sensual or animal appetites. Moderation, eating, drinking, and sleeping. There's some people that just like to sleep all the time. Now, I didn't get that one because I don't like to sleep. Brother Paul's raised his hand. All right, I found the one for Brother Paul tonight. Okay, thank you. Brother Paul admitted that. All right. No, he doesn't get to, though. He works too much. All right, but Brother Paul's just saying, I don't get to do it, but it's my thing. And I don't get to do it, but I'd be really good at it if I could. All right? I understand, Brother Paul, I do. Now, me, on the other hand, I don't like it. I mean, I like sleeping a little bit, but then I'm like, okay, I'm ready to go. I can't take it. Like, some people can go in and be like, I'm going to take a nap during the day. I'm just going to go in there and take a nap. And they're out. I'm like, how do you do that? How do you just do that on demand? Like, the whole room is full and loud and everything. How do you do that? My kids can do that. My kids can do that. You get it quiet? Is that what you said? You'd get fired? Yeah, if you'd fall asleep at work, they'd find Lee falling asleep at work, and he'd be fired. I don't know. I don't have that problem. I have other problems, but that's not one of them. All right, I don't have the sleeping problem. I got others. But anyway, all right. The Bible says, what does the Bible say about the bishop? It says the bishop is to be temperate, okay? To be prudent or be sober-minded. In Titus chapter 1, verse number 8, it says, but a lover of hospitality, a lover of good men, sober, just, holy, temperate. Amen? That's a qualification of a bishop, is to be temperate, self-control. Have control over oneself, over the passions, the appetites, the desires of your life, to be able to have control over those. And by the way, that's not some self, when I say self-control, again, it stems from the Holy Ghost placing that fruit inside of you. It is not from your own self. It just means that you exercise that gift and control oneself. That's what it means. Understand that. That's what differs us from the athletes that have self-control. Right? Athletes can have self-control. They can deny their flesh. They can not eat. They can starve themselves for a weigh-in. They can do a ton of things. But in all actuality, that's not really that's not a biblical self-control. Amen? Do you understand the difference? It's not biblical to starve yourself like that in a self-control like that. But what is it? It's their version of self. It's the world's version of self-control, which is different than God's. Amen? Different. So anyway, but the Bible says he's to be a lover of hospitality, a lover of good men, sober, just, holy, temperate. All right, how about this? Now, you thought you got out of it, but you aged men, you didn't get out of it either, because Titus chapter 2, verse number 2 says this, that the aged men be sober, grave, temperate, sound in faith, in charity, in patience. Amen? You've been saved for a while, aged in the faith, that you be sound, you be sober-minded, you be grave, you be temperate. That's serious, having a seriousness, not intoxicated with the cares of this life, but a serious soberness to what's going on in this world. And temperate, you don't lose it. You are an example to others as an aged man. You are to be an example to others. Amen? You are to be an example of controlling oneself and controlling your emotion. When something happens, you don't lose it and fire off the handle. Amen? That's the way we're to be. Like what one man said, he said, because money, food, riches, honor, and the like can take a man easily. And that is why he is not to be a novice, lest he be lifted up with pride, as far as the bishop goes, and come under the condemnation of the devil. You know, money, food, riches, pride, any of these things can get in there. That's why the man of God has to be able to be temperate in all things, right? Because he has a lot of advantage to be in excess. He has more advantage sometimes than what you might have to be in excess. So he has to be careful that he doesn't allow things to take him because of the double honor that is showed to him. Amen? Which, by the way, is biblical. There's nothing wrong. There's a lot of hate for pastors today. Biblical pastors. I understand the hate for the hirelings and the phonies, but there's a lot of hate for biblical pastors today. Hang on, I'm going to open this water here. Don't hate me, all right? Garrett's looking at me kind of funny, I don't know. Are you thirsty, Brother Garrett? All right, brother, I'll give you some water. Here you go. See that? That was slick, wasn't it? Nathan can't stop laughing over. He's like, man, that was pretty good, actually. He's thirsty. Anyway, all right. All right. I'm hoping to heap coals of fire on his head. No, I'm just kidding. He could put it out with the water. No, that's not true. I was just kidding. Anyway, but it's easy with double honor. There's a lot of hate for pastors today, though, right? Oh, man, you shouldn't honor. No, the Bible says double honor, and it means it, too, by the way. It really does mean it. Amen. And I have no complaints. God takes care of us. Amen. And so do you. So I'm blessed by that. And others that, oh man, the Lord has just built, praise the Lord. The Lord has blessed people around the country. When they're fed, they take care of our ministry here too. And I appreciate that. I'm very thankful for that. The Lord always takes care of us. But temperate in all things, in eating and drinking, continent from the lusts of the flesh, and even abstaining from those things which might be lawfully used, though inexpedient, for the sake of the weak, for the peace of the church and the glory of God. Do you understand there's some things that, I mean, it's not a sin for you to do, but it just might negatively influence your brother. And maybe you shouldn't do that. Why? Because you want to be temperate in all things, right? Maybe you can get away with doing something else. Maybe you could do some of these things. And maybe because you don't, and it's a good idea for you not to do it. Why? Because it's not expedient for you to. Because if you do, hey, what if you cause a brother to stumble? What if you cause somebody to stumble into something else? Right? That's where we show temperance, where we show self-control. I might lead somebody astray by that. Maybe it's lawful for me to say something, but maybe it's not expedient for me to. You know, that's one that you better be careful about. You may have all the right in the world to say something, but maybe it's not expedient for you to. Maybe you'll cause more damage by saying something. And maybe you'll hurt or wound a weaker brother or a baby Christian by saying it. And maybe you better just be careful about saying something like that, because you might just hurt somebody. Though, hey, it's lawful for me to say it. Yeah, but is it expedient? Because temperance is what says, hey, okay, wait a minute. This is not expedient. I better be careful. I could say this to this brother. I could let him know this, or I could say this in front of him. But maybe I shouldn't, because maybe I might weaken his faith, or I might hurt him. You think about that. Amen? The sense here on the gifts, or the fruit of the Spirit, is this: that the influences of the Holy Spirit on the heart make a man moderate in all indulgences, teaches him to restrain his passions, and to govern himself, to control his evil propensities, and to subdue all inordinate affection. What does that mean? It means taking the mastery of myself and my body. Amen. And my emotions and my heart. It's taking the mastery of it. It's taking control of it. The Christian will not only abstain from intoxicating drinks, but from all exciting passions. He will be temperate in his manner of living and in the government of his temper. This may be applied to temperance properly, so-called with us, but it should not be limited to that. A Christian must be a temperate man. And if the effect of his religion is not to produce this, it is false and vain. Wow. Abstinence from intoxicating drinks, as well as from all improper excitement, amen, is demanded by the very genius of his religion. And on this subject, there is no danger of drawing the cords too close. Think about that. No danger of drawing. You can't, listen, what he's saying is you can't have too much self-control. Amen? You can't. We might think we can. But we can't. We can't have too much suffering. Listen to what he says. He says, no one was ever injured by the strictest temperance, by total abstinence from ardent spirits, liquor. Amen. No man was ever hurt by abstaining from alcohol. Amen. But I know a lot of men that nipped a little bit and ended up what? Drunks. Amen. That's right. And from wine as a beverage. No man is certainly safe who does not abstain. What does he say there? He said, if you don't abstain from that, you're not safe. You're playing with a serpent. You're going to get bit. You're not safe. You're not wise either, by the way. The Bible says it's not wise. Amen? I like what he says. He says, nothing does more scandal to religion than such indulgences. And other things being equal, he is the most under the influence of the Spirit of God, who is the most thoroughly a person of temperance. Why? Because temperance involves denying the flesh. Right? Temperance involves denying the flesh. Right? Amen? That's what it involves. And that is not fun. That's right. Amen, buddy. That's not fun, is it, denying the flesh? No, it isn't. Right? It's not fun at all. Especially when somebody makes good cookies and stuff. I mean... Man, it's not, it's right. Brother Nate knows. That's right. I'm telling you. Brother Paul calls those a meal, not a cookie. That's not a cookie. That's a meal. Sure is. And hey, it's not intemperate to have some once in a while. Amen. One, not more than, not some, one. Okay.
One meal.
One meal. That's it. Amen. Those are good cookies. But amen. But it's not a sin to do that. It's a sin to be intemperate with it. Amen. We have to understand that. And that's, by the way, that is different for every person and for everybody. What their body can handle, what they can do. It's different for everyone. It's not the same for everyone. And nor are you the judge of what somebody else should do. Amen? You and I are not the judge of what somebody else should do. But everyone should be mindful of one another, though. And put others first. To think, if I cause a stumbling block, I shouldn't do this. I'm not going to cause a stumbling block for brothers, so I'm not going to do this. Amen? We all battle the flesh in different areas. You and I can have the knowledge of this book that is possible for a man to have, all the knowledge of this book that is possible for a man to have, and if your life has not temperance, you are a sounding brass and a tinkling cymbal. Amen? That's what you are. If we don't have temperance, if we don't have self-control, if we can control the passions and the desires of our heart and our life. Listen, this is building on your faith. That's what this is. Preaching these kind of messages is what building on your faith is. Okay? That's what they're for. They're to make you uncomfortable, you and I. They're to make us feel that way. So we challenge ourselves because the Holy Ghost is challenging you. He is challenging you right now through this. Say, hey, am I temperate in all things? And I can honestly tell you, none of us are. Okay? We all have challenges in our lives of things. That's why God says, preach this, because we all need it. Amen? I don't pretend it's going to be my most popular sermon. But it's one you should listen to more than once. Amen? It really is for all of us. Failure to bridle the tongue renders our religion useless. Temperance of the tongue, James chapter 1, verse number 26, right? That's temperance of the tongue. That's what that is. See, it didn't use that term, no, but it explains it quite well. Amen. James chapter 1, verse number 26, turn there. If any man among you seem to be religious and bridleth not his tongue, but deceiveth, and bridleth not his tongue, but deceiveth his own heart, this man's religion is vain. Whew. You know what vain means, right? Empty, worthless, lack of substance. Amen? That's what it means. So if you and I can't control our tongues, what does that mean? Well, we're given the appearance that we have vain religion. That's why God allows us to repent of that. Well, it says the tongue can no man tame. Who tames it? God does through the Holy Ghost. Amen. So what does that mean? That means you have to exercise temperance. Just because you can say some things doesn't mean you should. Just because you're right about it doesn't mean somebody else needs to know about it. Amen? Did you know that? Just because you're right about something doesn't mean everybody else should know. Sometimes you keep some things to yourself. Because I'm going to tell you something right now. As a pastor, if I didn't keep things to myself and I said everything that I know, it wouldn't be very profitable to you. It would do more damage than it would good. That's why it's good to use wisdom and to bridle the tongue and to temper the tongue. Amen? And to be careful what we say. Amen. It's called loving. Amen? There's a lot of people that can argue doctrine or teach people the Bible, but they have no control over the flesh and their passions and desires or addictions, whatever you want to call them. This temperance is designs both chastity and sobriety. It's both. Chastity and sobriety, and particularly moderation, eating and drinking, it may be observed that these fruits of the Spirit are opposed to the works of the flesh. So love is opposed to hatred, joy to emulations, envying, peace to variance, strife and seditions, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, and meekness to wrath and murders, faith to idolatry, witchcraft and heresies, and temperance to adultery. fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, drunkenness, and revelings, to be sober. Amen? All those things, those works of the flesh talk about what? Excess, living in excess, not being able to control ourselves. But God says you have no excuse because I've given you all things that pertain unto life and godliness. So you have it, now exercise it, now work it, and stop making excuses. Well, what does it come down to? It comes down to denying the flesh and taking up your cross and following Christ. Amen? It is that crucified life. Sometimes you and I have to divorce, so to speak, our passions and our desires and our wants. And we have to lay those things aside and say, Lord, I'm going to do what's best. And I'm going to obey you. Amen? There's a lot of things that you may want to do in your life. Well, that's great. But who really cares? Does God want you to do them? We always talk about, I want. Wait a minute. What about what Christ wants? What about what Christ wants? Remember, this life is not about you. I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. That's your life. That's your life. That's your life now. It's not all about what you want. It's about denying my flesh and being crucified to the flesh. Man, I want to tell this person off. Wonderful. Does the Holy Ghost want you to? No? Then shut up. Amen. Don't say it. Hold your tongue. Don't say what you want to say. Don't do what you want to do. Amen? It's not about what you and I want to do all the time. We would define Christian sobriety as the regulation of our appetites and affections in their pursuit and the use of all things. We can be righteous over much. It is the governing of our inward and outward man by the rules of moderation and temperance. It is the keeping of our desires within bounds so that we are preserved from excess in practice. It is a frame or temper of the mind, which is the opposite of excitedness. It is a being temperate in all things, and that includes our opinions as well as our conduct. Interesting, isn't it? Turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 9. I've been telling you about this verse for the last 10 minutes or 20 minutes. We should read it. So 1 Corinthians chapter 9. All right, man, I got to hurry up here. All right, 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse number 25. And every man that striveth for the mastery is temperate in all things. All things. Now they do it to obtain a corruptible crown, but we an incorruptible. We're going to talk about this in a second. He said, I therefore so run, not as uncertainty, so fight I, not as one that beateth the air, but I keep under my body and bring it into subjection, lest that by any means, when I have preached to others, I myself should be a castaway. Notice he didn't say he beats his body. He beateth against the air, but he doesn't beat his body, okay? But he says he keeps his body under subjection, amen? He keeps his body under subjection, lest that by any means, when I have preached to others, I myself should be a castaway. Amen. What is this? What is he talking about? It is a holy seriousness, a soberness, a calmness, a gravity, a balance, which prevents one from becoming extreme. Now, not extreme for the Lord, but an extremist in the flesh. You understand? We want to be. You can't be extreme enough for Jesus, amen? You can't be extreme enough for the Lord. You can't walk enough in the Spirit. Wow, that was weird. You can't walk enough in the Spirit, okay? You can't be close enough to God ever. You can always be closer. You can always obey more and more, amen? It is that self-control which keeps us from being unduly cast down by sorrows or elated by joys. Yeah, that this casting down of sorrows, you know, being cast down from, being totally consumed with sorrows of this life and being in depression, being depressed. What do you think it was? It was temperance that kept Job, isn't it? Yep. Right? Consider Job, right? My servant Job, said the Lord. There's none like him. Amen. Amen. He eschews evil. What happened with Job? Man, Job had everything taken from him, but you know what? His emotions never overcome him. Some of you don't have a third, a fourth, a 100th, and I don't have a 100th or a 1,000th of what Job went through, but you have a little bit of struggle in your life, and you melt completely down and lose it. And your emotions take you over, and it's like you have anxiety, and you build on your anxiety. What are you not doing? Well, number one, you're not walking in the Spirit, and you have given yourself over to an emotional overload. Emotional overload. What is that? You're not being temperate in all things. You're not. That's a fruit of the Spirit. The first thing you need to do is repent. You need to repent because you're in sin. Well, did you think because you weren't mass murdering or looking at pornography or yelling at people or being mean to others or beating anybody or anything like that, that your sin was any less important to God? Was it any less of a transgression for you to have an emotional breakdown, go into hysteria or anxiety or anything else? Did you think that was okay for you to do? It wasn't as grievous of a sin to the Holy Ghost of God as if somebody else flies off the handle and punches somebody in the face? No, it's just as wrong for you to be in anxiety. You're just as much walking in the flesh and just as much in sin as the next person is. And you need to repent of that. You need to repent of that and get it right. Amen. Think about that. All right. It causes us to hold the things of this life with a light hand so that neither the pleasures nor the cares of the world unduly affect the heart. That's what temperance does. Are you listening? I'm going to read that to you again. I'm going to read a little slower here so you catch on to it quicker. It causes us to hold the things of this life with a light hand so that neither the pleasures nor the cares of the world unduly affect the heart. Right. Temperance is what? Stability. Amen? It's stability. There is a spiritual childishness as well as a natural one, wherein the young convert acts more from an impulse than principle. Man, I've seen that before. People that first get saved, whoo-wee, man, they're acting completely on, man, I think we should just, bam, let's go do it. Whoa, calm down, killer. Wait a minute. Put the squirt gun down. Quit trying to charge hell with it. Calm down a second. Let's think about this for a minute, okay? Let's just think about this. Let's walk through this, okay? I'm not hating your zeal. I love the fact that you have zeal, but let your zeal overrun you, amen? Let's talk about this. Let's work on this for a minute, amen? Think about this. Think through everything first before you do this, before we do this, amen? That's right. Because they act more on impulse than principle. Is carried away by his fancies and is easily influenced by those around him. Many young converts are, you got to be careful around them, to be tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine, is one of the characteristics of spiritual immaturity. Man, they're jumping from one doctrine to the next. They're jumping off. Man, these people are everywhere. You see them on Facebook all the time, man. They are just, pew, 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 pew. Man, one minute they're here, then they're into hyper-dispensationalism. They don't believe in repentance, then they believe in repentance. They are all over the board in like 2 weeks, you know? And what I usually do from people like that, I usually just try to stay away from them. When you land somewhere, you call me, okay? Right? But I'm not watching you fly in the air anymore, okay? Go submit yourself to a local church, get underneath the pastor and learn something, amen? Oh, that's not very popular, no, is it? All right. And when we waver in faith and are of a doubtful mind, listen, and when we waver in faith and are of a doubtful mind, then we halt and falter in our duties. Amen. That's exactly what happens. You start getting all the doubts and fears. What do? You halt and you falter in your duties. You don't do what God wants you to do. The devil's got you on another path, man. You're over here fighting something that isn't even there. Man, you're fighting a ghost. And I don't even mean a demon. I mean something you made up in your mind that ain't even there. And you've made that thing so big and it's not even real. It's you. What do you have to do? Repent and practice biblical temperance. Amen? And exercise temperance and self-control. Amen? Even that love which is shed abroad in the hearts of the renewed needs to be controlled and guided, as appears from that petition of the apostles. Turn to Philippians chapter 1, please. Chapter 1 and verse number 9. Look at what he says here. He says, "In this I pray, that your love may abound yet more and more in knowledge and in judgment." See that? Knowledge and in judgment, that you may approve all, approve things that are excellent, that you may be sincere and without offense till the day of Christ. Amen. Being filled with the fruits of righteousness, which are by Jesus Christ, unto the glory and praise of God. Amen. He wants them to be what? Have good judgment. He wants them to have self-control. He wants them to have temperance. He doesn't want them to get carried away with everything. Amen. Then we see in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse number 6, "Therefore let us not sleep as do others, but let us watch and be sober." Self-conquest is the result of the Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit's work. The Holy Spirit overcomes the self-life and gives the victory over our lower nature. It is well for us when, like Luther, we distrust ourselves. And I like what Luther said. I'm not a Lutheran. He was wrong about baptism. I don't even know if the guy was saved, to be honest with you. But he did say something that was true. He said this, "I am more afraid," said he, "of my own heart than the Pope and all his cardinals." You think about that. I mean, remember the Pope's trying to kill him, right there, all the cardinals trying to kill him. But he said, "I'm more afraid of my own heart than theirs." So am I. You know, because chances are you're not going to lead me astray very easily. Amen? Right? I mean, you are not going to lead me astray very easily. But my own heart? Oh, wow. Now that could lead me astray very quickly. Amen? Very quickly, I could be out of the way by trusting in my own heart. What is that? When your heart and your emotions, the seat of all affections and emotions, when it takes you over, and what happens? You get anxiety, you get fear, you get doubt, you get all these things. And what? Now you're being controlled by your emotions. You're just running on emotion, pure emotion, pure emotion, pure emotion. What are you not doing? Walking in the Spirit, trusting God, believing in His promises. Exercising the gifts of the fruit of the Spirit, adding to your faith temperance. You're not doing that. You're carried away. You're carried away. Amen. Look to Christ for strength to live the overcoming life. It is the secret of power amongst men. It was his own self-mastery that made Alfred the King, Alfred the Great. "So long as I have lived," said he, "at the close of life, I have strived to live worthily." What did he mean? He wanted to control himself. He wanted to be in self-control. He wanted to have that control. It says, and add to your knowledge temperance, and to your temperance patience. Bear and forbear. Sustain and abstain. Deny yourself and take up your cross daily. The more knowledge you have, the more renounce your own will. The more you understand the scriptures, the more you understand, the closer you get to God, one thing you will say is, "Wait a minute, not my will, but thy will be done." What did John the Baptist say? "None greater born among women," right? And what did he say? "He must increase and I must decrease." How about that for power? How about that for understanding his life? That means what I want must decrease and what he wants must increase. What his will in my life is must increase. What mine is must decrease. Amen. That's John the Baptist. What's that? Wait, I'm sorry? Yeah, decrease. Yeah, amen. Yeah, amen. I must decrease. That's right. Amen. 24 down. Amen. All right, good. So keep going. Amen. That's right. Praise God. Amen. All right. He says to indulge yourself less. Knowledge puffeth up, and the great boasters of knowledge, the Gnostics, were those that turned the grace of God into lasciviousness. But see that your knowledge be attended with temperance. Christian temperance implies the voluntary abstaining from all pleasure which does not lead to God. It extends to all things inward and outward, the due government of every thought as well as affection. It is using the world so to use all outward and so to restrain all inward things, that they may become a means of what is spiritual, a scaling ladder to ascend to what is above. Amen. Using but not abusing this world. Amen. I'm going to use what I have to do in this world, but I'm sure not going to abuse it. What is it a life of truly? Self-denial. It's a life of self-denial. Isn't that what the Christian life is supposed to be? Your flesh wants to get into evil. Your flesh loves sin. If you're a man here, you'd be a liar if you didn't say that almost everything on that list of the works of the flesh, your flesh would love to jump into right now. And if it wasn't for the grace of God, you'd be doing most of those things on that list. Amen? Come on. Some of you ladies could say the same thing in different areas. You'd be doing a lot more things you could if it wasn't for the Holy Ghost of God in you. Amen? I don't pretend there's any good thing in me. I know there isn't. It's just Christ in me, the hope of glory. Amen? That's it. We don't have anything else to brag about. We got nothing to brag about. Nothing at all in this flesh, in this fallen flesh. Oh, by the way, I have a question for you. If sinless perfectionism is true, then why does God tell us to exercise temperance? You bunch of phony liars. Anyway, all right, I'm going to keep going here. Bunch of phony liars. What a bunch of liars. How do you lie to yourself like that? You're so deceived. You better get saved. You're going to split hell wide open. You're going to get saved, man. Who are you fooling? That's right. Intemperance is to abuse the world. He that uses anything below, looking no higher and getting no farther, is intemperate. He that uses the creature only so as to attain to more of the Creator is alone temperate and walks as Christ himself walked. Amen. You know why the cause of Christ is suffering today in our age? Because God's people are not temperate and holy. They're not walking in the Spirit. They're not temperate. They haven't mastered that. And we have to master that. We've not mastered the flesh. We've submitted to the flesh and not the Spirit. Be not drunk with wine, wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit. Be not excessive and control yourself. To give in to fleshly desires is sinful. We need to have some self-control. Amen. Paul said, know ye not that they which run in a race run all, but one receiveth the prize. So run that you may obtain. And every man that striveth for the mastery is temperate in all things. Now they do it to obtain a corruptible crown, but we an incorruptible. So what's he saying there? He's saying, do you wish to gain the prize at the Olympic Games? That's what he's describing. Consider the requisite preparations and the consequences. You must observe a strict regimen. Must live on food which you dislike. You must abstain from all delicacies. Must exercise yourself at the necessary and prescribed times, both in heat and cold. You must drink nothing cooling. Take no wine as formerly. In a word, you must put yourself under the direction of another, as you would under those of a physician, and afterwards enter the lists. What is he saying there? I mean, he's not talking about the Christian life. He's giving an example of what an athlete does. For you, it is different. It means walking in the flesh and having self-control. That means the things that I know that I have the authority or the power to do, I don't do. By the way, just curious, you know God has authority to do a lot of things, and he doesn't do it to you either. I want you to think about that for a second. God could really humiliate you if he wanted to, but he doesn't. God could treat you very poorly. God could treat you what you deserve, very easily, couldn't he? But he doesn't. I wonder if you and I ought to have a little bit more grace and mercy for people and not treat them like they deserve, but treat them how Christ would and show some mercy sometimes. That's so important in a body like this, that we're careful with each other. Amen. By the way, the days are coming, folks, when this is all we're going to have. Some of you now, this is all that you have. Take heed that you not waste and spoil it. You better love one another. Amen. You know, an old salesman told me, love the one you're with. Amen. He said, love the one you're with. So what does that mean? It's pretty simple, isn't it? If you're on sales and you have another appointment and you're in an appointment and you're doing really well and you think, he said, you better love the one you're with. Don't worry about the next one. Love the one you're with. Amen? We're here together. The Lord has brought us together. You better love the one you're with. Amen? You're married to a wife. You better love the one you're with. Amen? It's a good principle, isn't it? All right. As an element of the Christian character, temperance, there are many elements that constitute this, but there can be no full-rounded Christian life without temperance. Amen? There is contained in it the further idea of self-sacrifice, so it lies at the foundation of the noblest of all lives. This is the principle that made the martyrs. Whew. You know, I don't know about you, but you start reading the martyrs' lives, you start feeling guilty. Not that you need to die, but just how much sacrifice they had and how much they loved the Lord in the most extreme, awful conditions known to man, and had a smile on your face, and some of you run out of gas and think your life's over. Right? Some of you don't feel good or you got a boo-boo and you're going to lose it. Right? I mean, you literally look like, sometimes you look like the most depressed people in the world. And thanks a lot for giving Christianity a bad name when you walk around looking like that. Oh, great. I want some of that Jesus, huh? Look at you. Think about it. Think about it. Yeah, that makes me want to get saved. Whew, let me tell you, that's a good testimony. Amen. That's good even if you don't like it, especially if you don't like it. Amen? Self-denial then occupies no secondary place. He who is not able to practice it is not worthy to be a follower of Christ. But how can this be unless we possess something of his spirit? The highest type of man is he who is likest to Christ in consecration and self-denying service. This is what we should aim at. It is the perfection of character. Shall Jesus bear the cross alone and all the world go free? Now, of course, we can't bear his cross, but he's talking about that cross of self-crucifixion. Amen? By the way, nobody crucified him. He gave up his life freely. Amen. Nobody's going to make you crucify the flesh. You have to give up your life freely. Amen. It's a daily decision. So it might behoove you to not walk around like the zombies we watched this weekend. But walk around with some joy in the Lord. Right? But I don't feel good. I got this going on. That's great. But you ain't dead. You ain't getting burned at the stake. Yet. Right? You're not losing your life. You've got a lot of blessings. I mean, why don't you, I'll tell you what, when you start feeling that way, why don't you get a piece of paper out and start writing down all the blessings you have? And then thank God for all of them as you go down the list. You know what I spent this morning doing when I was driving? I was praying, and I spent this morning as I was praying and driving down the road. Actually, it was like around noon or so, and I was driving down the road, and I was just thanking God for everything. I mean everything, everything that God has given me. It's hard to be in a bad mood when you do that. It really is. And if you can't think of anything, it's because you're a selfish person. And you think too much about yourself. And you really should stop doing that. Because it's idolatry. Ooh. That'll hit home in a second. Herein lies the guarantee of conquest. Let self be put down and Christ lifted up. And then not only will the life be itself a success, but it will be a power for the moral conquest of the world. For we can influence others only in proportion as we live under the power of the truth ourselves. The world will not readily be impressed with that spirit which makes self-interest its end, nor be struck with the excellence of that faith which makes no sacrifice. We owe it to Christ. We owe our salvation to the practice of the principle on his part. Think what he gave up for us. We owe it to ourselves. How many are there who from protracted pandering to the cravings of their lower nature have lost the power of self-control? We owe it to our fellow man. If Christ denied himself for us, should we not also deny ourselves for the brethren, and like the noble apostle of the Gentiles, become all things to all men? He's temperate in all things. These luxurious Corinthians were much addicted to their belly. He calls them therefore to temperance. Ill doth it become a servant of the highest to be a slave to his palate, and to have animum in, I don't know what he's saying, he's speaking another language here. And may a man may eat that on earth that he must digest in hell. That was trap. He always says things like that. But anyway, say they were taken over by their appetite, basically. Well, let me ask you, as we're going to close here, because I'm running out of time anyway. Have you added self-control to that chain of faith? Have you exercised it? Let me ask you some questions. Do you have self-control over your emotions when things don't go right? Can you deny your flesh? It's self-denial. Denying ourselves and taking up our cross and following Christ. Lady, when your husband tries to correct you about something, do you lose it? You get angry, upset, out of control, maybe even in rage, or lose it emotionally. Maybe you don't have self-control over time on social media or time of leisure activities or time on fun things and are not disciplined enough in those areas. Maybe you don't sleep enough, or maybe you sleep too much. Amen? Either way, we need temperance. Husband, when your wife tries to tell you something isn't right, can you handle it? Did she speak to you and tell you that something's right? Or do you lose it? Do you lose control of yourself and be like, I'm the man, you just be quiet? Start grunting? Yeah, like that? No, I'm just kidding. But sorry, Brother Ryan, I had to. It was funny. It was good timing. Do you have control over your anger when the kids upset you? How about it? Do you have that self-control that is submitted to Christ and his righteousness? How about when someone gives you some criticism, can you handle it? Do you melt down and flip out in a crisis or a rough time and emotionally fall apart? Good questions, aren't they? Listen, you can read the Bible, lead your family, point to worldly people when they're wrong, but can you control your own temper? Is your temper under subjection to the Holy Ghost? Or do you have a bad temperament? Do you not practice temperance? Do you have self-control over your finances and money? Or do you spend money like the U.S. federal government? Well, you'd have to steal it to spend it like that, so maybe you don't do that. But anyway, yeah, you have to print it first. Right? So I'm just using that as an example, though. And the Fed, that's right. How about it? Do you have self-control or temperance in your life concerning those things? Listen, God is never going to give you more until you show some control over what he's already blessed you with. Sometimes we want more responsibility, we want more from God. We want maybe more exposure, more of this. I don't know, whatever it is in your life that you want. Sometimes we want more, but you know what? If you're not a good steward of what God has given you, if you're not grateful for what God has given you, I'm telling you, there's one thing that I will deal with my children with, and that is ungratefulness. The first thing I start doing when they become ungrateful is start to take things away. Amen? I just start taking it away. Well, you don't care for that, so you ain't getting it. You complain about that? Okay, well, you don't need it. So I'm going to take it away from you. Then you won't complain about it anymore. Do you ever think that God might do that to you if you murmur and complain too much? He might take something away from you? How about that? Think about that for 1 second. If I murmur and complain too much, would God take something away from me? Well, he did take the promised land away from those, and they died in the wilderness. Fiery snakes, all kinds of things. I think you better be careful about how much you murmur and complain about God's providence and his goodness in your life. Amen? Don't try and tell me you're more spiritual than God when you can't control your temper and your finances and your emotions are out of control. You're lying to yourself. Well, how do I add this? Well, first, all of it stems from a self-knowledge, understanding where I'm at, taking inventory of your weakness and your faults and characters. and your character flaws, and guard them like you are guarding your very soul. If I am prone to do this, then I must stay far away from this. Amen. If I am prone to lose it in certain conditions, then I must be prepared for those conditions. The second step is intention. It is not enough to acknowledge a fault or a weakness, but you must purpose in your heart that you will stay away from the scenario that can cause you to fall. If I'm going to fall in a situation, I don't need to be around that situation. I need to keep myself far from that situation. Right? Amen? I'm not gonna go around a bar or near bar or hang around people that go to bars if I have a temptation for alcohol. I'm not gonna even put myself in that position. If somebody tries to hang out with me and they're gonna have that, or even somebody that I work with or something, I'm gonna tell them, listen, I don't want any of that garbage around me. You stay away from me. I ain't going anywhere near you with that. You ain't gonna hang out with me with a liquor bottle in your hand. I'm just gonna walk away from you. I don't want to be around you. Amen. The third step in self-control is habit. Here we go. Habit. Form good habits. Form good habits. If you're doing, if all these things are happening to you because you're doing these, then start to form good, positive habits that will help you to walk in the Spirit and to exercise temperance. When you start to, that's the first thing I had to do when I, 4 weeks ago. I said, okay, I'm going to start. Boom. Here we go. What am I going to do? I'm going to form good habits. I'm going to plan everything that I'm doing. People ask me, do you really have to be that rigid? Yep, I sure do. Amen. You really have to be that rigid? You bet I do. And just keep going. But I had to form good habits. And now 4 weeks in, now it's like, it's just like second nature. I don't even think about it. It's like, boom, boom, this is what I'm going to do every day. Boom, boom, this is what I do every day. Why? Because it's a habit now. It's a habit. I wake up, I know what I'm going to do. I've already got it planned. I've formed a good habit. Fixed attitudes of the mind determine courses of our conduct. I'm going to read that to you again. Fixed attitudes of the mind determine courses of our conduct. Get this. In a time of crisis, when there is no time to think, a fixed mind will do what it is habitually used to doing. Amen? Now, you know that, don't you, Brother Paul? When you practice in the military, you have to practice for shooting and different scenarios and different things, and you have to do that. What happens? It's a habit in your mind. You're already used to doing it. You know what you're going to do. You could do it with your eyes closed if you had to, but you would do it. Why? Because it's a habit in my mind over and over again. Though a hazard comes up, I know exactly how to handle it. Why? Because I've already practiced it. It's a habit. It's been in my mind. It's been on my mind all the time, and I just know what I'm doing. I do this. This is what I do every day. You know, what different scenarios. Well, if I go here, what am I going to do? Well, I got a plan for it. See, so I got a plan. I'm in this position. I got a plan for it. This is what I have to do. Yeah, it takes work, okay? You can't be lazy. There's no laziness to this Christian life. It's impossible. You cannot be a lazy Christian and be successful for the Lord and to be prosperous. You cannot be. It's work. This Christian life is work. I know I'm running out of time, but I don't care. I'm going to keep going. All right. Anyway, let's see. I think I'm almost done here. All right, the vital importance of self-control. Lack of self-control or temperance is the beginning of sin. You will fall without self-control, and it is a needless fall. It's needless. You don't have to. Self-control builds us, builds our character in the life of a person, in the life of the person. No one has ever had good character who did not have self-control. Amen. Some people fall apart over everything. They need temperance. People will not follow a man who has no self-control. I've seen a lot of leaders where people wouldn't even follow him anymore. Why? Because they didn't have any self-control at all. I mean, they would get mad. They would get angry. They would blow up. They would do this. If something happened, their leadership style was just to rip people apart. People are like, I'm not going to stick around this. I'm out of here. I don't want to be around a boss like that that blows up all the time and loses his mind and gets mad about everything and yells at me and gets angry with me. I don't want to be around that person. I'm going to leave. What is that? That's a bad example is what it is. It's a man that doesn't have temperance, right? God will not use a man to his fullest who has no self-control. Your children are watching how you deal with situations every single day. Mom or dad, if you flip out and lose it, they're watching. Mom, when you lose your temper, you give your children an excuse to get angry with their siblings. Dad, when you and mom don't control your emotions, or wife, you cry all the time when someone spills milk or a bill is due or anything else, you fall apart. Your kids are watching. They're watching. Your daughters, your sons, they're watching. They're watching how you deal with things, and they're picking things up, and they're putting them in their mind and their heart, and they're going to mimic them one day. And they're going to do it to their brothers. You're like, where'd you get that? Oh, you know where they got it from. Right? You know. How do you handle it, by the way? The lost and dying world is watching us. It's vitally important you and I get this thing down of adding to our faith virtue into virtue, knowledge into knowledge, temperance. It's important to have self-control because you can indulge in certain activities that other brothers or sisters will try, and they may fall into sin. It may be a snare and a trap to them. It helps you look at others and care more for them before you do your own desires. Amen? Think on these things, would you please? Father, Lord, thank you for this. I pray, Lord, that it would sink into our hearts. Help us to live it out every day of our lives, Lord, as I know you want to use us more and more for your honor and your glory. Thank you, Lord, for your mercy towards us. Thank you for the fruit of the Spirit, which is temperance. Help us to live it every day of our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.